Okay. So this is where we stopped by the sorry, here. We got the formula for the FVA in this one-period setup. And CVA, which appears here, has been computed before and is given by this formula here. So now let's have a look at the symmetric companions of CVA and FVA, which are the corresponding contra liabilities. It will be DVA and the one we call FDA for funding debt adjustment. So these values correspond to cash flows, and the cash flows are, so L, if you remember, was the loss and profit of the bank. With a minus in front, it becomes the profit and loss. And if I put one minus J in front, which means bank default, this is in fact what the liquidators of the banks are getting. Okay. And what we obtain, if we go a little slide behind, this is the sum of the two bottom lines here. And these cash flows here, I will value by the so-called DVA. And the last line, I will value by the so-called FDA. So the sum of the two values will be the total values of cash flows, which we call contra liabilities. So whatever cash flows are posterior to the default of the bank. So let's go back to the valuation slide, which is here. We have DVA, which is therefore given by this formula here, and FDA by this one. So can we say a little bit more about these values? So first of all, the risky funding cash flows are centered under Q-star. So E-star of F is zero. In other words, E-star of JF equals E-star of minus one minus JF. And this is how much they are each worth. And as a consequence, if we remember that FVA was E-star of bank survival risky funding cash flows F plus one minus J FVA number. Here, I can substitute this E-star of GF by this guy because they are equal in value. And then what I recognize here is the quantity I defined earlier as FDA, which means FVA and FDA coincide. This is of course not a big surprise because it only reflects the fact that risky funding cash flows are assumed to be fairly priced by the market. So E star of F is zero. About what more can we say? I can decompose credit cash flows as pre-bank default, post-bank default, the same for risky funding cash flows. I call fair valuation of counterparty credit risk the Q-star expectation of all the credit risk cash flow, whether it is default cash flows or risky funding cash flows. And then I have that because F funding cash flow is centered under Q-star, this FV actually reduces to E star of C. Now I'm splitting C as JC minus one minus JC. I am inserting one minus JCVA here and there to see CVA minus DVA appear because this is CVA. We recognize CVA here and we recognize DVA here. And because CA is CVA plus FVA and CL is DVA plus FDA, where these two guys coincide, this FCVA minus DVA is also CA minus CL. Maybe I forgot to define CL. I should have written here that let CL be DVA plus FDA, where these are the two components. I don't see CL before. I need to add it. So, conclusion, the fair valuation of counterparty credit risk is CVA minus DVA, or equivalently, CA minus CL. Now let's go to the next floor of the bank, and let's consider capital at risk and its cost, which is KVA. So, as we explained this morning, the regulator wants to see on the table as capital at risk, at least economic capital. And what we, the way we model economic capital is ongoing concern in a sense. So when a bank computes capital, the bank does not include its own default in the calculations. You know, in reference to that, we model ici as unexpected shortfall under this bank survival measure Q that we introduced before, that we found instrumental this morning. So expected shortfall, 97.5% in thinking of this 40 yearly adverse events that we want to be able to pass successfully. And then we take here the shareholder trading loss, so the losses, the trading losses of the bank. Actually, and one may make the observation that this JL is centered under QSTAR, and therefore, I mean, this is the expected shortfall of SAPSIG, which is centered, and therefore it is positive. I insisted this morning that all our capital levels should be positive always. So this is the case going by this definition. Oh, out of this, given this EC amount, we explained this morning, based on the picture, I'm showing again, the regulator wants to see at least EC. But there is already RM, which is there, and which can be, which is eligible to serve as capital at risk. It means the shareholders themselves only need to put at risk from their own pocket the difference between RED and RM, which is the difference between the max of EC and RM, alias KVA and KVA, which is the positive part between EC minus KVA. Again, if the bank should show, let's say, 100 of capital at risk, but there is already 60 sitting there, which has been provided by the clients. It's only 40 that the shareholders are really risking. And therefore, the target hurdle rate of H equals 10% means the management will give to the shareholder 10% of this amount that they risk. Okay. However, this is only tangible if J is equal to 1, so bank survival, otherwise the shareholders do not perceive this thing. And there is also this, so this is cost for management of giving this to shareholders. And another cost center, if you want, is that if the bank defaults, we explained in our rule of the game that any residual value on either the reserve capital account or in that case, the risk margin account is lost for the bank and goes to the liquidator. Which means this is the KVA amount that the management needs to charge to the client to be able to serve to the shareholders the hurdle rate of H proportion to their risk in the event that they survive. So that's one more of these equations, of these fixed point equations, which is in fact less complicated than it seems, because passing to the bulk survival measure, we realize that this equation is equivalent to this simpler equation under the bulk survival measure Q. I'm saying simpler because I got rid of this implicitness here. It is still implicit via the minus KVA plus, where KVA also sits on the left. But because this is just a constant number, we can forget about the expectation operator. And this is one more of these semi-linear algebraic equations with a positive coefficient here, so that the equation is well posed and this is a solution. H divided minus by 1 plus H is easy. And it's interesting because we observe that the fact that the KVA is also loss absorbing, so the presence of this minus KVA here has the consequence that in the KVA final formula, the EC has to be discounted at the hurdle rate H. So the final formula reads H 1 over 1 plus H EC instead of a more naive but unnecessarily conservative formula that would be H EC. And you can imagine that when we go to continuous time and long time horizon, realistic time horizon for XVA computations, fact of discounting economic capital at a rate of 10% per year is of course very material. Okay, so it means a KVA which will be maybe 40%, so half of what it would be without this this discount here. So, wrapping up, the all-inclusive XVA add-on, which aligns the entry price of the deal to shareholder interest. So this all-inclusive XVA add-on we call the funds transfer price, initiated by FTP. So that's FTP equal the sum between the add-on, which is charged by the CVA trader and the treasury, which is CVA plus FEA, which is interpreted as expected cost of counterparty credit risk to the bank, plus this cost of capital that you may view as a risk premium, KVA. And it's interesting to split this further as CVA minus DVA, which we show equals the fair valuation of counterparty credit risk to the bank, plus, so I need to add the DVA that I subtracted before. Here I can replace FVA by FDA because we show that they are equal and we leave KVA untouched. And then we recognize three terms, fair valuation plus this contra liability value, which I'm calling here a wealth transfer for a reason I will explain a bit more in a minute, plus this risk premium. And again, the random variable which is used to size the economic capital in the KVA formula is the bank shareholder, loss and profit, JL, which in this static setup reduces to this, but in a dynamic setup, you would also have terms related to the risk of the due to the risky funding. Okay, so why am I calling this guy wealth transfer? The point we want to address now is there is something, some inefficiency here, because if I go back to the picture, we have some value on top, which is in fact only value to the liquidity of the bank, which corresponds to value of cash flows which are perceived by the bank after its from its default time onward. Wouldn't there be a way for the bank to monetize these cash flows beforehand? Why couldn't they, maybe by some kind of hedging strategy, get this value earlier and therefore at a time where the bank shareholders would truly benefit from it? This is our next question. So let's see what it would mean concretely, such a strategy. That would mean, let's assume, just temporarily for the sake of the argument, that the bank would be able to hedge its own jump to default risk through a new deal, whereby the bank would deliver a payment minus bank default, loss and profit of the bank. So this is this windfall benefits that the bank is making when the bank is defaulting. Okay. So now we are saying through this new deal, which would come on top of the client deal, the bank would deliver this amount at time one, and that would come in exchange of a premium, of course, and the premium would be fairly valued as E star of this thing, okay, which we saw before to be DVA plus FDA, which would be deposited in the reserve capital account at time zero. So accounting for this new deal, let's say the client would now pay instead of minus MTM plus CA before, he would now pay minus MTM plus FV, that is, we would reduce its the reserve capital extra price paid by the client from CI before to CI minus CL. Okay. So now we have this extra deal, which is earning to the bank the amount CL at time zero. But we ask less to the client. We ask CA minus CL, which means it's always the same amount CA, which goes into the reserve capital account of the bank, because it's now a CA minus CL from the client. So less money comes from the client, but it's compensated by the premium of the new deal. And because it's the same amount as before in the reserve capital account of the bank, it means the bank still needs to borrow the same amount on the market to implement its strategy. MTM that the bank is receiving from the client minus the very same CA as before. So the borrowing cost of the bank is still the same gamma positive part of MTM minus CA as before. And the bank trading loss, which was before C plus F minus CA, if you remember. So I'm going back to the L in the lemma. C plus F minus CA. I just explained how F does not change because there is still the same amount on the reserve capital account. C has no reason to change at all, because C is only between this thing is not affected by the new deal. So this is, however, is changing because now the bank is only sourcing from the client minus CMS minus CL, which is FV, as we showed. So if I go back to my question, the P&L on the side of the client deal, market edge included, is now the C plus F minus FV instead of before C plus F minus CA. But there is also the impact of the new deal, the P&L of the new deal, which is this CL gain, so this minus CL loss by the bank, plus this minus 1 minus JL that the bank is paying. So this is the total loss and profit of the bank in this new framework where the bank is making this new deal on top of the client deal. And then the FV plus CL makes CA. We saw that before. That's where we are. Okay. But the C plus F minus CA is the former L. Okay. So ultimately, we get JL, the very same JL as we had before, which was this GC minus GCV, so CV PNL, if you want. Which means, under this new setup, where the bank is doing this new deal under these terms, and following the strategies that we described in this slide, the loss and profit of the bank is actually unchanged. It is the same. Okay, same on the variable. But the client is better off. The client is paying less. He's paying CA minus FV, which is CL, instead of CL. Sorry, I mean, the client was paying CA before. He's now paying FV. So it's better off by the difference, and the difference is CL, which is positive. The losers, in fact, are the creditors, the liquidator of the bank. Because all the money that the liquidator of the bank was getting previously has been actually wiped out by the new deal. So they do not get anything. As for shareholders, by construction, they are indifferent. They are always indifferent to the duly priced deal. It means in that case, the shareholder gets less from the client, but it's okay because the difference is gain on the new deal, and this difference is gain at the detriment of the creditors. Okay? So summing up, the CL originating cash flow has been edged out and monetized by the shareholders, which have passed the corresponding benefit to the client. And of course, the benefit of the shareholders is that they are now more competitive, which means they have a greater chance to attract the client because their price is better. There would still be a KVA in this situation because the PNL is unchanged, so the exact same KVA as before. If, however, the bank would also hedge the default of the client, it's only then that the bank trading loss would completely vanish, therefore the KVA would vanish, and that the FTP would reduce to FV, which, if you remember, is what we now ask to the client, and which, as we saw before, equals CVA minus DVA, or CA minus CL. Okay. So, now you understand maybe why I called this C element wealth transfer. This is because in a world which corresponds to the real world where the bank does not have access to a deal, which is this new deal in which the bank is supposed to pay something positive in the scenarios where the bank is in default, which is not practical. So such a contract is in fact forbidden, because it would be a fake contract. I mean, the real value, or if this contract should be traded, it should be for zero premium, because we know in advance that this will never be honored by the bank. So if this fictitious hedging instrument was available to the bank, then the bank would ask much less money to the client, namely FV. However, in reality, this contract doesn't exist. It's not accessible, it's impossible, it's forbidden. And therefore, the bank has no other option to align the deal to the interest of the shareholders than charging to the client heavy plus CL. So confronting the two results, we conclude that CL is interpreted as the wealth transferred to the liquidators by the derivative portfolio of the bank due to the impossibility for the bank to hedge its own default. So it's really wealth transfer. The bank has no choice. I mean, if derivatives should be traded by the bank, it implies unavoidably that some money, if you want, is diverted by liquidators, and the bank has no other option than passing the corresponding cost to its client. Okay, and that's why I was answering this morning to the question, do you think that DVA has really nothing to do with the price? So indeed, from going by these conclusions, I mean, you see that the proper XVA to be charged to the client is really this one, CVA plus AVA KVA, as opposed to in perfect and complete market of counterparty credit risk, what would only be CVA minus DVA. But in the gap between the two, which is DVA plus FDA plus KVA, is unfortunately cannot be compressed, and simply reflects an intrinsic incompleteness of a counterparty credit risk. Which means that in the sequel of this course, I will not talk very much more about DVA, FDA, etc., once their role has been clearly understood. In fact, in the continuous time chapter, I perform the exact same analysis to the exact same conclusion. So this slide, for instance, is equally valid in a continuous time. Okay. But it's simpler to do technically in one paired setup, but it passes through exactly the same way in continuous time. So I will not redo that. I mean, it's just continuous time technique, but the message is exactly the same. So those amongst you who are curious can read the slides themselves. I will not pass time in the lecture redoing it in continuous time. It's really exactly the same conclusions. What I want to do, however, next, still in the static setup, is to include important practical features, that is, variation margin exchange between the bank and the client, and the initial margin that is received by the bank from the client, and I denote it by received initial margin, so RIM, whereas PIM denotes the initial margin posted by the bank to the client. Just if you want to, just to give an idea of how these numbers could be devised, one could say that because the client is owing P to the client, but there is also a price MTM, so we would say that the client should post to the bank a value at risk of this P minus MTM, whereas the bank would post, the bank is in the symmetrical situation where the bank owes to the client, if you want, MTM minus P. So the bank would post to the client an amount of initial margin given by value at risk of MTM minus P. So let's say this is now the extended setup, okay, where the the client is posting to the bank VM as variation margin. This VM can be positive or negative. So it is, if it is negative, it is effectively the bank is posting the minus VM of variation margin to the client, right? And on top of that, each is posting to the other a certain positive amount of initial margin. The difference between VM and EM being that VM is re-hypothecable, whereas initial margin is segregated and cannot be re-hypothecated. So then I could revisit my lemma, okay? And I will not redo the computations, but I'm just giving you the result. The result that when I have before in the P&L of the bank is JC, where C used to be P plus, redoing the computation by applying these abstract principles of chapter one, which were saying how VM and how collateral affect the cash flows, the result is that in C, one needs to replace the positive part of P by the positive part of P minus VM minus RIM, which of course is very intuitive because given this collateral, VM plus RIM, that the client has posted to me, if the client defaults and owes me something, the residual debt net of the collateral is just this positive part. Okay? And because this RIM is typically a significantly high positive number, the new CVA, the CVA under, I mean, with a collateral, let's say, sorry, would be typically smaller or even much smaller than the uncollateralized CVA, sorry. Okay, that's where we were. That's how CVA is affected by the VM from between bank and client plus initial margins between them. Let's see how the other XVAs are affected. Now the bank needs to borrow not only our previous F, but an additional amount PIM of initial margin that the bank needs to post to the client and therefore to borrow. Okay. And this triggers an additional adjustment MVA in CA coming on top of FVA by this amount, which is an equation of the sort that we are now used to, and which is therefore easily solved as gamma PIM. Symmetrically to this new contribution to CA, we have a new contribution to CL by the amount of actually MVA, because we assume that borrowing is fairly priced in the market, so the initial margin related cash flow are also value at their expectation, therefore NDA equals MVA. As for FVA, it changes a little bit because whenever we add MTM minus CR, whereas CR was before CVA plus FVA, CR is now CVA plus FVA plus MVA, so this is a new guy. And therefore, when we solve the equation for the FVA, that's what we get. That is, we have this new guy under the plus, okay? Moreover, the CVA is not the same as before, it's smaller than before. The last feature we want to integrate in our equations is that the bank can use not only CA, but also its capital at risk as a free funding source. So the bank doesn't need to borrow an amount MTA minus CA plus to implement strategy. The bank only needs to borrow MTA minus CA minus capital at risk, which corresponds to the maximum of economic capital in the KVA, and that's everything positive part. Okay. Alors, here, one remark is that the bank has two, let's say, two funding sets, right? One is related to funding re-hypothecable collateral, and one is related to funding the EM that the bank needs to post. So when I'm saying that there are these three funding sources here, one may say, after all, why wouldn't these three funding sources be devoted to diminishing the EM funding debt as opposed to the variation margin funding debt? Because MTM is interpreted as the amount of variation margin that the bank is posting as a collateral on its edge. Okay. So the reason why we do minus CA, minus CA, minus RC applied to MTM as opposed to why not apply to PIM, the reason is that you can indeed use capital as a funding source for variation margin freely, because when you do use capital as when you post cash as partial margin, it doesn't affect your capital. For the reason which is explained here, you don't have less capital. Okay. Whereas if you post capital as initial margin, what you get is as a corresponding entry on your balance sheet is a margin receivable, okay, which is an asset, but this asset does not contribute to capital because it is too illiquid and you cannot unwind it without unwinding your portfolio. Okay, so you can only play this game of using your reserve capital and capital at risk for funding purposes for the purpose of funding your variation margin. This is a justification. So now what happens? So now we are still considering collateral, but again, on top of it, we want to account for this possibility for the bank to diminish its funding debt by using its capital as a free funding resource. Okay. So what is changing? CVA does not change again. Okay, it is the same as in two slides before. The PNL of the bank is now given by this expression, because if you remember, in the presence of margins instead of P plus, in the CVA cash flow, we should insert P minus VM minus RIM plus. This JL determines the KVA by the same formula as before, via the same logic as before. And then one can make the observation that this quantity here is less than is less than EC, actually. This expected shortfall corresponds to economic capital. And the factor here is, what I want to say is that the maximum of EC, what I want to say is that simply this H over 1 plus H is of course less than 1, because unless of course h would be more than 1%, but not the case. I mean, h is like 10%. So this factor is less than 1. So this whole thing is less than EC. And therefore, the capital at risk of the bank, which in principle is the maximum between EC and the KVA, well, the max is not binding, and the max equals EC. That's what I want to say. And that's also an interesting message, because when we are in dynamic setup, continuous time model, and we do the computations, the Monte Carlo, etc., it's also typically observed that the max is not binding, in the sense that this max of EC and KVA process typically reduces to EC process. But still, because we now have VM minus VM. Let me check something here. So here there is a mistake. I forgot that the client is posting money to the bank as a VM. And the VM posted by the client can be used by the bank as a source of VM on its edge. So it should really be MT minus VM. That's the question was asked this morning. Are we including this kind of effect on the sensor? Yes, so that's a typo. This one should be MTM minus VM. As it is rightfully stated here. MTM minus VM, minus CVA minus MVA as 2 slides ago, but in the meantime we have added this term, so that's what we get as the final LVA formula. Okay, so in the end, I mean, in this static setup, we have a complete understanding of everything, and we have explicit formulas for all the XVAs, okay? So we are missing nothing except for something essential that we cannot use this static setup in practice, because again, there is no way to squeeze your portfolio with 1 million trades spread over 70 years into a single static cash flow P. Makes no sense, okay? So that's why we have to make it dynamic, which is the next chapter. Okay. So to a large extent, this next chapter is redoing everything we did in static setup, except it is in continuous time. So the technical tools will be much more elaborate, but all the messages are the same. Okay. So I will not cover this in totality during the lecture. I will leave most of this chapter for the interested readers. Okay. My goal is to take you as soon as possible to the real thing, which is X millimetrics for bilateral trade portfolios in continuous time, to the second part of this course, if you want. Which is a computational part, okay, which will be next week. So I will just cover a few of these just to show you, to give you a flavor, I mean, of the tools that are at hand here. So because the setup is now continuous, it's not only about a measure Q star. We also have a filtration, which I denote by this G T. I call value now process, not only time zero value, but value process of a financial cash flow stream. Well, as usual, I mean the conditional expectation process of the future cash flows. Okay, and we can say it's risk neutral, because if we are talking about financial cash flows, they are in the small sigma algebra, so their Q star value is in fact a risk neutral valuation. And risk-free discounting will be implicit through the choice of the numerator, so we don't have to bother with risk-free discount factors. If you remember, I said upfront that we do all XVA computations on a runoff basis, but it's worth being repeated here because now time flows continuously, so we could do it differently, but we still want to do it this way. And at the end of this same chapter here, I will basically show a few slides and jump over the chapter till the point where we explain this trade incremental XVA computations, which are, if in a sense, a relaxation of this assumption. And we have a final horizon V, big T, which is the final maturity of the portfolio, so greater than any maturity of any claim we have in the portfolio. And even including the time it takes to liquidate defaulted positions. So T would be longest maturity in the portfolio plus 1 month, so that we are sure that at time big T, every default has been settled, okay, where we assume that default settlements take bounded time, so like no less than 2 weeks. That's standard assumption. If we are talking about centrally cleared trades, it should be less than that, like a few open days, less than 1 week. If we are talking about bilateral portfolios, people in the market consider that the default should be settled in maybe 2 weeks max. I'm not talking about a legal settlement of the default of defaulted counterparty. I'm talking about liquidation of the portfolio. Of course, legal liquidation doesn't take 2 weeks. It takes more like 10 years, if you think of Lehman Brothers. It's not completely finished, the legal liquidation of Lehman Brothers. Now the default time of the book is modeled as a random time, tau, which can be a positive or plus infinity value. So the survival of the book is now a process. And this survival indicator process is one before tau, drops to zero at time tau. We assume the default time, the book default time as an intensity, which means technically that the differential of this indicator process plus intensity dt is a martingale. It's an additive martingale. We also have the multiplicative martingale, which is j multiplied by exponential integrated gamma dt. For any left-limited process, y, like all our prices, cash flows, etc., there is this notation, which is standard in probability, to denote a process F stopped not at tau, but right before tau, which means this guy, by definition, is Y itself before tau, so as long as this J is 1, so before tau, whereas from time tau onward, this process is worth the left limit of Y at tau. And then the companion notation is this, to denote y minus y stopped before tau. So this guy is y restarted before tau. This guy is y stopped before tau. So let's say that would be a trajectory of y with, in this scenario, a jump at tau. Then the corresponding trajectory of y stopped before tau would, of course, be the same before tau, but then instead of jumping, it would continue by the same value. Whereas this process Y starting before tau would be 0000. At time tau, it would take the value in that case minus something, and then it would have the same increments of than Y. And basically, this Y stop before tau will play the same role if continuous time as our form, as a random variable 1 minus j y, sorry, as jy before. So this sig is a continuous time analog of jy before. And this guy is a continuous time analog of 1 minus j y before. So this morning, y was a random variable. Today, y is a process. So that these are the objects that we then need to introduce. And then this morning, the instrumental probability tool was this bank survival measure. In continuous time, the most powerful tool at our disposal to deal with the similar analogous issues is reduction of filtration. So we'll have a smaller filtration. So this should be F G double bar. The default time of the bulk is not a filtration, is not a stopping time in the smaller filtration. In fact, we assume that the proba that tau is greater than final maturity given F big T is strictly positive. That's a technical assumption. But now we assume that to any G predictable, respectively optional process, we can associate a unique F predictable, respectively F optional process on zero big T, coinciding with the original process until tau, respectively before tau. And I mean, this is not a strong assumption. This is indeed the case that any G predictable or optional process has this, let's say, representative, or we call it reduction, in F, whenever, for instance, G is F progressively enlarged by tau. Okay. And where our setup is a bit, let's say, more flexible than the standard progressive enlargement of filtration setup I just mentioned is we assume not only a smaller filtration J, we also assume a potentially different measure P equivalent to Q star on FT with, let's call it, invariance martingale property stated in these two bullet points, and that's why we call P invariance property measure. Maybe if you take a martingale with respect to the small filtration basis, so smaller filtration and change measure, then this local martingale, if you stop it before tau, you get a GQ martingale local. And conversely, if you start from a GQ local martingale which doesn't jump at tau, and then the reduction of this process will be FP local martingale on zero big T. So that's our setup. The reason we introduce this measure change on top of the reduction of filtration is to have basically less more general setup. And in particular, we want to be able to have within our setup potentially a strong wrong way or right way risk between the default of the bank and the portfolio. Okay. Whereas if you, let's say, restrict this setup to P being equal to Q star, well, that means you are in this probability framework that is known as immersion, which implies some conditional independence, let's say, between default and market, given F infinity. So we don't want to necessarily assume this condition independence. That's why we make it a bit more general. Then we call a clean valuation of a cash flow stream in F, the corresponding FP valuation, conditional expectation of future cash flows if you want. And we denote by ESTRT and ET the conditional expectation with respect to the original stochastic basis and the one with respect to the new smaller basis, which will be the instrumental one. So the ESTRT is a financially meaningful one, and the ET is more auxiliary kind of tool. Okay. And this is the lemma, which in continuous time plays the same role as the two lines lemma that we had in the one-parent model, which allows us to simplify this kind of equations, where you see that we assume that straight y is the valuation of accumulated cash flows, bold y, perceived between t and tau excluded. Okay. And yt is also valuing y tau minus. So what this equation is telling us is that, so the bold y are cash flow streams, right? And now I'm taking a shareholder-centric perspective. The shareholder will only be affected by pre-bank default cash flows. So the shareholders will only be hit by this subset of the cash flows. But in this XVA framework, whatever residual value at tau, it's also lost by the shareholders because any residual value within the bank, in case of bank defaults, goes to liquidator. Which means, very much like in the static setup, all our XVA equations will fall in that class. Okay, it's only the nature of the bold y cash flow which will differ. That is, this bold y will be successively this, bold p, bold c, bold f, bold d, etc. Okay, but this is the mathematical nature of our equations. And then the lemma is that you can show the equivalence between straightwise solving this or and the reduction of straight y, which I denote by y prime, solving that. And the equivalence holds, in fact, both in spaces of local martingale solutions, the background, or in spaces of square integrable solutions. And the interest of this lemma is that this equation here is, of course, much simpler than that one. This one, at first sight, is a quite unusual equation because it has a BSD flavor, so backward stochastic differential equation. And the y in the past is ESTRT of blah, 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 plus y in the future. But it's not even y at the future big T. It's not even y at tau. It's y before tau, which makes it unusual. If you think a bit of it, it's as if that it's a kind of backward SDE stated over a random time interval, endowed with, instead of a Dirichlet condition as usual, so we specify the terminal value, you can reformulate that and show that it is more in the flavor of a Neumann terminal condition where you are saying that the value process does not jump at tau. That's how you can look at it. So it is not standard. But it's not a complete novelty either, because this falls in the scope of what Duffy, Schroeder, others called recursive valuation equations. So it was already considered credit risk. These kind of equations has a relatively interesting history. The most mature approach to solve them mathematically is to address them by reduction of filtration, as we do. I will not even sketch the proof. I mean, you can have a look yourself, but basically the proof is of course, using the assumptions, the invariance martingale setup that we have, Now, the original approach to these equations was a bit different. First of all, in the original paper, the paper by Diffie, etc., was, of course, very pioneering, but there were some technical issues. So they missed basically some mathematical subtleties in the solution of the problem. So they didn't get the right solution. Then an important step was made by Colin Dufresne, sorry. Oh, sorry. Okay, so that's an Econometrica 2004 paper where they showed how the, let's call it the Diffie equation, the recursive equation, could be solved rigorously by using as a tool a measure change from Q star to Q with this density process. I briefly mentioned, if you remember, this afternoon that we had this multiplicative martingale, J times blah, blah, okay? So that can be used, even if it is not positive, it vanishes, this guy is killed at town. You can still use it to define an absolutely continuous, but not equivalent measure change. So it's a singular measure change from Q star to Q, where you can go from Q star to Q, but you cannot come back to Q star, right? And in this paper that we did to, as I said, generalize progressive enlargement of filtration to make it more flexible, we realized that this clean valuation that we do is essentially equivalent to this Q valuation in the sense of Colin and Dufresne. And one can even show that our measure P is nothing but the restriction to FT of their measure Q, okay? Now, what happens is that if you really want to solve a bit sophisticated equation, etc., we found it more convenient to do it by going reduction of filtration way than by going singular measure change way, because basically when you do this singular measure change, you have less, technically you are more limited. For instance, because you cannot come back, you are not even sure that you have preservation of semi-martingale in both directions, etc. Integrability is also less easy to deal with via this singular measure change. So we view this FP way of doing it as let's say the modern way to address, the complete way to address computations under the singular survival probability measure Q. Singular respect to Q star. And finally, just the mention that the mainstream immersion setup, which is well known to probabilists, is the one where P and Q star coincide on FT. And we just said that in general, P is equal to Q, so everybody is on the same on FT. So and of course this object Q is very close now to the tool that we did use in the static model, which was this Planck survival measure. So very natural question: is this Q measure the same as Q star given tau greater than big T, let's say, as we add in the static setup? Not quite. Not quite, and the precise connection is as follows. Going by the definition of this Q, a simple proof shows you that Q-Star of an event A given tau greater than big T is EQ of indicator of A discordant weight gamma or gamma prime. Gamma prime is a representative, the reduction of the F representative of the default intensity process of the bank, divided, normalized by expectation of numerator. So what this is showing us is that it's exactly when the pre-bank default intensity gamma prime is deterministic that this Q measure is nothing than Q star given tau greater than big T. Because then you can take this exponential out of the expectation you really get Q star in by the Bayes formula. You recover Q star off. And if this thing, sorry, if what I want to say is that if gamma is deterministic, this expectation plays no role. You have simplification of the two exponential and you get Q of A, right? Which means Q of A is Q star of A given tau greater than big T. If, however, Q, gamma is stochastic, this is not longer the case. Okay. And then the story continues really like in the static model. So we call P is now a process of the cash flow to the clean desks. We call C and F the cash flows paid by the CVA and the FVA desks. What will happen essentially is that P will correspond to the contractually promised cash flows, but not exactly. Now about the counterparty credit cash flows, C, well, we will see what they consist of as soon as we postulate a concrete setup, like saying, okay, now we say that the bank is involved into a bilateral trade portfolio with clients, or perhaps the bank is dealing its edge via a CCP. And then by application of the principles of chapter one to a concrete setup, that's what we will be able to say what is P, what is C, what is F, okay? What is generically true, what will always happen, all the concrete situations we look at, is that C will be a finite variation process, that is the difference between two increasing processes. And C stopped before tau will always be increasing, which means that basically before tau, C is only made of losses for the bank corresponding to client defaults. Regarding the risky funding cash flows F, again, their exact nature depends on the financial network, so we'll come to example soon. But what will always be true is that F is a martingale, therefore it is zero value. And before the default of the bank, F will only increase, whereas after the default of the bank, F will only decrease. In fact, the canonical structure of this F is that the bank is losing and losing. The bank needs to fund itself, so to pay, to borrow money. And if the bank defaults, there is a big windfall benefit of the bank corresponding to the fact that the bank does not reimburse its funding debts. And that's always how this F will look like. And as for the hedging cash flows, the proceeds of the hedging strategy of, in fact, the clean desks, because we assume that it's only the clean desks that are hedging themselves. Okay, there may be different cases, but think of it as a martingale, so zero value. With this peculiarity that H stop before tau it should also be a martingale. And that's the continuous time form of this consistency assumption that we had in the static model, that Ep should be equal to E star P, because basically otherwise either the shield of the bulk would be unhappy and reject the team, or the clean desk would not be able to find edge counterparties. So for the same reason here, we have to assume, and it's reasonable to assume, that H satisfies this double martingale property for itself and for H stud before tau. Now the big difference is that in static setup, this consistency assumption was together very reasonable, but at the same time restrictive, quite restrictive, whereas here in continuous time, when you think of it, it's not really restrictive because in particular, it is true for all the martingales which do not jump at tau itself. So in particular, it's true for all continuous martingales. So we are saying that the edging proceeds of the clean desks, okay, can be any continuous martingale or any martingale which doesn't jump on tau. Or, and this is even the most interesting part, if we are in a standard progressive enhancement of function setup, let's say all the F martingales. So if you view F as, let's say, the filtration for market risk, then every single thing, the clean desks, would happen in F, and therefore this technical assumption would always be satisfied. Okay, so this was, let's say, the mathematical discussion, okay, where I just wanted to give a flavor of how in continuous time the ideas are exactly the same, but the mathematical apparatus is much more complex, okay? But once this apparatus is in place, you can, you know, that's why I'm not detailing, I'm just passing the slides without any comments. We have these XVA equations, which are fixed point equations, which are simplified by the lemma. Of course, economic capital is now dynamic, so it's conditional on T, okay? But you see that the connection between shareholder capital at risk as a whole is the same as before. KVA obeys an equation of the same structure as the other XVAs. So this formula is of course extremely important because this is the final continuous time KVA formula, which after passing to the FP auxiliary stochastic basis reads as follows. So reduction of KVA, KVA prime, so KVA before default equals ET of integrated hurdle rate, capital at risk, and here you have this discount at weight H, which is a continuous time version of the fact that because KVA is less absorbed, it diminishes the shareholder capital at risk requirements, which diminishes the KVA, corresponding to this discount factor here with a very large, you know, rate like 10%. So this thing here, if you don't have it, your KVA numbers will be two times bigger, which means if you forget this, you might call it a subtlety, even though it's very substantial to the KVA that it is less absorbing. But let's say if you forget, if you are a bit, you know, if you just proceed by analogy, and if you define the KVA just like the other CVA, CVA just like one more, which would also be a liability. So if you are simplistic in this way, then you would not have this exponential, and you conclude that your KVA needs to be very large, and which is totally unnecessary because the right value is this one, economically speaking. So that's where implementing the right equations make your XVA number much more reasonable. And also a very interesting observation is that this formula here is a continuous time analog as the risk margin formula for insurance. So under the Swiss solvency test cost of capital methodology, which means our XVA approach is like can be viewed as an adaptation to banks and also a full-fledged dynamic version of the Solvency II regulatory framework. And I already made this comment this morning in reply to one of you, that this KVA formula here, so I call it a formula even though it is still an equation because KVA sits left and right, but as I said this morning, in practical cases, this KVA, tends to be less than ici because of the structure of derivative portfolios, which have this bulk after a few years. And therefore, this max, you can essentially see this max of ici and KVA as ici simply. So that's why I call it a KVA formula. And even if KVA does sit there and you want to account for it, I mean, you can easily show that this KVA equation is well posed. Same kind of idea as this morning. I mean, this morning, static setup, we had a KVA semi-linear algebraic equation with a KVA which was a bit like that, the max of ici and KVA. Now, of course, it's more involved because it's a backward stochastic differential equation, but it's not difficult to see that the Picard iteration that you can imagine corresponding to that equation is contractive and therefore converging. This is well defined. And now this KVA formula, let's call it this way, time zero, you can really use it in both modes. I mean, either the management could use it to say, okay, our objective for next year is to target a hurdle rate, which would be 12%, knowing that today it is 10, okay? And you can use it in the implied mode. So back to the picture, let this be your balance sheet today. So this is the amount on the risk margin account, whatever it is. And you can, you can play it implied, not implied vol, but implied H. So by computing the KVA for various values of H, we can show that this is increasing in H. So the dichotomy is not difficult. In a few iterations, you would compute a few values of H, you would find the H for which the KVA fits the actual amount on the risk margin account. That would be your implied hurdle rate. And this is beautiful because it's a single number that you can use to report to the management of the bank and which conveys all the richness of your portfolio, which is hidden as input L to EC. Remember that EC is an expected shortfall of the PNL in the next year, and this PNL is essentially a CVA and FVA PNL, or if you want to put your edge as it is in the equations, in the data, not assuming that your edge is perfect, that's also fine. that would contribute to the L, all the dependencies would be reflected in your computations. So, including market credit correlation, credit credit correlation, all that can be embedded. Okay, and still, all your portfolio would be put as an input exactly as it is. I mean, you don't have to simplify or to, and all this data would be processed into a single number, okay, which can really be taken as let's say, a derivative, financial derivative analog of a return on equity. That's what it is. Now, let's make the connection with dividends more precisely. So this result is telling you that shareholder capital, although maybe it's not different, let's check whether it is defined in the slides. Maybe that's right to add it. So shareholder capital is a sum between shareholder capital at risk and whatever amount of uninvested capital that the shareholders may have outside the bank. And the proposition is that if the shareholders do nothing except being involved in this business with the bank, then their equity actually grows as the initial value plus these accumulated dividends, where this thing here means the default losses that they do, the negative of which contributes to dividends, if you want, and then the minus, so the depreciation of the KVA means, if we go once more to the picture, if this account diminishes, it means the management took money out of this box to give it to shareholders. So that's, this is in terms of that bit here. And the proposition is that the shareholder equity, first of all, is given by this formula, so it grows by these dividends. And more precisely, you can show that this dividend process, so their equity, is a submartingale. So it tends to grow on average. And the drift coefficient of this submartingale is 10% times their capital at risk, dynamically over time. And then, I'm also briefly mentioning that our portfolio wide XVAs are non-negative. And also, they do not have this tendency to diminish when the credit risk of the bank itself spikes. That's an important observation too, which means we are in line with the regular requirements that I mentioned as a starting point today. Okay, now this is very much like what happened in discrete time. And these two, the last point I would like to make today is when I go to the realistic case of a trade incremental portfolio. Okay, then the extension of the approach is to say that at each new trade, the XVA add-on that should be sourced from the client is this incremental XVA amount. So every delta here refers to the difference between, let's say, portfolio CA for the portfolio including the new trade minus portfolio CA for the portfolio as it is without the new trade. Let's say we now consider incremental portfolios, and this is how each new deal will be priced by the broker. And then the theorem is that our previous proposition, which was this, which was saying that shareholder equity grows on average at the rate h times the risk, this is still valid. So under the trade incremental cost of capital XV approach, where all computations are made on regarding portfolios assumed L on a runoff basis, but you are playing this trade incremental add-ons at every new trade. And the theorem is that, again, shareholder equity is still a submartingale on R+, which means consistently between and throughout deals with a risk coefficient, which is still given by hurdle rate H times their capital at risk. Which means, and I can conclude by showing one of the first slides again. So this one, if you remember, the goal was to avoid this kind of things by installing a policy of reserves for the bank so that the pricing strategy is sustainable, that is, shareholders get an insured return rate on their risk, whatever happens, let's say. And the theorem that I just showed, show that the approach that I presented today is definitely an answer to the problem, right? So maybe it's not the only answer, but at least it is an answer. So I can conclude today's lectures on that. I see the question in the chat. So Elsa, you are muted, so.
Yes, there are two questions in the chat, Stefan.
Okay.
So I will ask the first one, as I have put it there. So on page 81, on equation 26, we have the expression that you spend quite a long time for the calculation 81. Of the KVA, the capital value adjustment. But this equation is like a recursive equation in meaning that the KVA prime is a function of itself.
But
how is this in practice solved, this recurrent relation?
You know, it's a recursive equation, but a very easy one. So it's one of these backward stochastic differential equations. Of course, I mean, when I said that I showed you that this XV approach is a solution to the problem, to the original problem, I still need to convince you of the fact that this approach is numerically feasible. Okay. So.